Colin, I know we're not the spring chickens we were when we set out on our first footy travel adventures, so I gotta ask, what's your secret?
My secret?
I mean, we all have our own ways of staying fueled up to spend entire days chasing that footy travel feeling. So what's yours?
Ah, I see. Well, I guess my approach can really be summed up in three words.
And they are?
Food is fuel.
You are quite the eater.
But of course, the type of fuel matters. I've found that the cleaner the fuel, the longer the energy. That's why whether I'm starting my day with a cool and refreshing smoothie or a warm and delightful cup of coffee or tea, I choose Laird Superfood for my beverage boosters or creamers.
Okay, tell me more.
Laird Superfood products are crafted from the highest quality, all-natural, real food ingredients and are sustainably sourced and thoroughly tested to ensure that you're incorporating the cleanest, finest fuel into your routine.
Are they made with whole food ingredients?
Yep.
Are they plant-based?
Sure are. And you know what else?
What's that?
Laird Superfood creamers and beverage boosters contain naturally occurring MCTs from coconut oil. MCTs, Mike. If only you had a different middle name. Those could be your initials.
If only I did.
Fellow footy travelers, are you ready to feel more energized, focused, and supported? Go to lairdsuperfood.com and add nourishing plant-based foods to fuel you from sunrise to sunset. Use our promo code FTP at checkout to save 15% off your purchase today. 15%. That's lairdsuperfood.com, promo code FTP.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the Footy Travelers Podcast.
So, Mike, I would wager to say that a lot of our episodes are person-centric, you know, us sharing experiences and stories about the people we meet. And this episode isn't necessarily too different from that. But I'm excited that this one is also very travel-centric, as we're going to learn about what I have a feeling is going to be a pretty incredible footy travel experience, you know, for those that are lucky enough to be a part of it. But how are you doing today, buddy?
I'm doing all right. That felt like very much a smartless intro. I feel like you're teasing me with who this guest is going to be. So I'm excited about that. But I am feeling a little under the weather for reasons of my own doing.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Say no more.
Celebrating birthdays, you know, for friends, it happens.
You have friends and you're a pretty special guy and you want to celebrate with them. I get it. And it is Sunday morning and some... You know, right. States of being are to be expected.
Right. Yeah. Thanks for being understanding.
I'm here for you. Well, I won't delay our guest any longer. We are here today with Merritt Hopper of Race to Adventure and Journey to the Games, two sports-centric travel experiences that, between the two of them, have been running for well over a decade now. Merritt is also, perhaps unsurprisingly, an avid fellow footy traveler, having been to... several World Cups, I believe. We'll have him clarify in a minute. Merritt and I also happen to be part of the same soccer club here in Denver. I as a coach, and he as a very supportive and cool-headed parent, I must say.
Yeah, good.
None of that Berhalter Reina drama here. I'll let you know that. So Merritt, with that,
yet,
welcome.
Yet.
Well, let's see how competitive we get. But anyway, Merritt, yes, welcome to the Footy Travelers Podcast. It's great to have you on today.
Thanks for having me. I could not contain my laughter any longer. That was an awesome intro. The Berhalter Reina, like, never even put that together until that moment. So,
oh, now he's seeding the idea. Now you have to start turning this into a drama.
First, I got to find dirt on Colin, but I just don't know if it's out there. So, I guess.
I hope I didn't just manifest something. Well, Merritt, we brought you on today to talk about one of these upcoming sports travel experiences you have, Race to Adventure, specifically because, and maybe perhaps for the first time, I don't know, we'll let you tell us, but the 2024 iteration has the potential to be a once-in-a-lifetime footy travel experience. So first tell us, you know, what the heck is Race to Adventure? How did it get started? And why is this 2024 trip exciting for footy travelers?
Awesome. So yeah, it would take me a little while, maybe an extra podcast to tell you all about Race to Adventure and kind of where it began, but I'm going to talk fairly fast for the listeners, just to kind of lay it on them, the foundation of Race to Adventure, right? So this stemmed from me working at the Eco Challenge way back in the early 2000s with Mark Burnett, who produced things like Shark Tank and Survivor. But before all that, he produced the Eco Challenge. So I was a part of that production crew in New Zealand, in Fiji, and I was watching these adventure racers just get beat up. I'm talking day and night, don't sleep, teams of four, near-death experiences. And I thought to myself, there's got to be a simpler way where you may not get killed if you want to participate in something overseas that involves athleticism. And so that's where Race to Adventure came from. So we walk or run or jog or race, whatever you want to do, 5K to 12K every morning. So, and then after that, it's like 10 a.m. You're hungry. You're exhilarated the way that you might feel it, like a turkey trot on Thursday, you know, on a Thanksgiving morning or a local 5K. You feel good. But what do you do right after you cross the finish line? You look for the beer tent because it's time to celebrate and you've earned your day. And so we basically apply that now to week-long, eight-night international adventures. So that is kind of the premise for Race to Adventure.
Okay.
How do I do?
I love that.
You had me at beer tent, I guess.
Yeah, where do I sign up? I mean, I will say I like that you softened the near-death experience into something that is more of a nice casual tourist thing. Yes. Because Colin and I love to go for runs when we're in new places. Colin probably more so than I, because this is typically how I feel after we touch down in certain places and Colin usually gets out. But there's no better way to see a city than to run it.
Yep, no question. And we find the trails, right? So there's a lot of road races out there, but like we find the best trails behind the scenes and send people out weeks ahead of time. You know, they're navigational, extraordinaire people that come from all over the world. We'll typically enlist someone that is local. And then we have our kind of evergreen talent that is navigational and course direction, and they combine forces. So we just got back from New Zealand in February, and Sergio Sanchez, who is my eternal course director, who lives in Costa Rica, who raced with Team Costa Rica at the Eco Challenge in 2019, he combined forces in New Zealand with Nathan Fave. Nathan Fave is the most decorated and most successful, most winning adventure racer of all time. Multiple books, an amazing person. He's a Kiwi. And so I told him I wanted to bring Race to Adventure down to New Zealand. He and Sergio combine efforts. I play a little bit of a part in that. And we put together the best races in New Zealand. So that's kind of our little spin on things. And now we're doing it in 2024 at the Euros. Should we go there?
Let's talk to the listeners a little bit about that. Mm-hmm. You know, whether you're just a footy fan or an avid, you know, footy player still as an adult, like some of us are. You know, running through Europe during the 2024 tournament could be exciting, but there's a special little twist with your trip, I think. So tell us about, folks will be traveling off of foot and, maybe the opportunity to get amongst that tournament, the Euro 2024.
Sounds great. So I hate to do this, but I will probably tease it just a little bit more and then I'll get to the punchline that is. It was very interesting. This was back in 2019 in Ireland. I had a racer in my van. You know, most of the coach buses had left. She was a little bit slower. I had her in my kind of my last nine participants van going to the next hotel. And she said, you know, Merritt, I love these. These are absolutely great. But Merritt, if you could design a way for me to not pack and unpack every day or every other day, that would be really amazing. Yet I'd want to see so much. So I know I can't have my cake and eat it too. And she said, but I don't know. What about like a riverboat through Europe? And I looked at Gail. Mm-hmm. Gail still comes on all these trips. I said, Gail, is it okay? Can I take that idea? Because it's brilliant. And so we took it. We took the riverboat idea. So I will cut to that chase, which is that in 2024, inside when the Euros are taking place throughout Europe, we have a riverboat floating through four countries during the Euros. The majority of that time will be spent in the host nation, Germany. So I would say about four or five of our nights and days are spent inside the host country.
Awesome.
Now, I got to rewind. Go ahead.
No, just that's fantastic. That's a great little chunk of time to be there.
Yeah. So, and I got to rewind because the story of how we got there And how this is going to happen is pretty cool too. So I took Gail's idea. Took is a bad word. I implemented Gail's idea and she loved it. We did it in 2021. We started in Budapest in Hungary. We stopped into Slovenia. And then we went, no, that's not true. We stopped into, let's get it right, Slovakia. Apologies. So we went from Hungary to Slovakia to Austria, spent a great deal of time in Austria, and then ended in Germany at the Oktoberfest. So we docked in Passau, and then our final party was at the Oktoberfest.
The ultimate beer tent.
The ultimate beer tent. Yeah. Exactly right. That's how it went down. And at every port, we had those 5K to 12K walk, hike, run, jog races that we always do. But then you got back on the boat and like this giant breakfast buffet was waiting for you. Or it was more brunch at the time. And then you roam the city. It's yours for the day. You know, there's not a lot of time that you will spend on a riverboat traveling daytime-wise. It's more like you start to eat dinner and then you look out the window. You know, you've got your filet mignon and you're looking out the window and you're like, are we leaving this country now? Oh my gosh. And you wake up and you're in the next country. So it's really such a special experience. We did this in 2021. It was an absolute success. People are like, when's the next one? When's the next one? When's the next one? Well, couldn't do it too soon because we take time to market and promote things. Like we can't be hit with an idea today and implement it 6 months from now. In 2022, I immediately got back in touch with the riverboat company that we work with. And I said, let's do the eastern part of the Danube. We did the western part. Let's go eastern. Let's go really kind of into that Eastern European places that people don't touch too much. And maybe because of uncertainty and safety, or maybe just because it's just a little too far east. Well, right before I inked that deal, Russia invades Ukraine.
Yeah. Hmm.
And the Eastern Danube doesn't sound like such a good idea anymore.
No.
So nope. So that was close, kind of Goonies style. Like, don't sign it. Wait, there's something on the news.
Right.
I'm about to take us through Romania and, you know, and parts unknown. And I had this idea, like this boom, bright light idea. And I went, wait a second. Holy cow. June 2024 euros, right? We all know what happens in even years, Footy Travelers. And so I was like, okay, hold on a second. Germany's hosting. I call up the riverboat company and I don't say a thing about it. I don't say a thing about what I've pieced together in 2022. And I said, so tell me, let's not do the Danube, right? Let's do the Rhine. And I see you've got this great 8-night itinerary that goes from Switzerland, stops in France. It touches in France. It spends a great deal of its time in Germany, ends in Amsterdam. What about that one? And they said, sure, we can do that. Like, we privately charter our riverboats and we can do that for you. And I said, send the paperwork. And I signed it.
There you go.
And what to them was an individual, you know, whatever, harmless private charter riverboat in June was literally setting sail inside the Euros and docking regularly inside the country hosting the Euros. So that is what's happening. And as you can tell, like, I'm like getting excited just thinking about it. I'm moving in my seat a little bit because it was not the original intention, yet it ended that way. And Colin, you'd asked before if I'd attended multiple World Cups. No question. Mm-hmm. I've attended multiple World Cups, a ton of Olympic soccer games, and this is going to be my first time being a big part of the Euros, which I've always aspired to do, right? I just love the concentratedness of that continent. I think we'd have to do the homework, guys, but probably, 13 of the top 20 teams ranked by FIFA are European? Something like that.
Quite a few, yeah.
Something like that.
And you think about Switzerland, they're going to be in it. Then you think about touching in France, they might win it. Then you think about the time you'll spend in Germany and how many teams are going to be there and people from all over the world and all over the continent that are going to converge on Germany. And then we end up in Amsterdam and you can bet we're all wearing orange, you know, to support the Dutch that day.
Love it.
So it's different than the World Cup, right? Because the World Cup, you support your red, white, and blue if you're from the U.S. In the Euros, you can kind of go and, you know, you can ask for the greatest games. You can cheer on no one. You can cheer on everyone. You can pick your fave. You can pick your underdog. And it doesn't hit home as much. It doesn't hurt as much if something doesn't go the way that you wanted it to. You get to watch the sport.
Plus, you're in Europe.
Right.
I mean, that's also a benefit. And the beauty of it is we have some fellow Footy Travelers that actually try to attend in continents where it's easy to go to the country that's playing in the final so that you can celebrate amongst them.
For
so
World Cups.
Going to for World yeah. Cups, but yeah, so even for Euros too. It, obviously, you're if you're in Europe and say Netherlands does make the final, you're already there and you could be a part of it, or say Germany's in it, depending on what you think about Germany's squad right now. But yeah. No, I think that's
maybe a host country run. Who knows?
Yeah, you never know. No, I think it's amazing. I love it. As soon as I heard the idea, I was like, oh my gosh, this is awesome. I need to sign up. So then the big question, like the big reveal, like how many spots are left on this trip? Some it's got to be like high demand.
It is high demand. We have two cabins left. So everybody, you know, hurry to race2adventure.com, book your cabin. But I would say this, there was a brief moment in time where I contemplated having two boats rather than one. And so, you know, the wait list will continue to grow for certain cabins that just aren't available anymore. And so I've got that big handful of contingents out there that are interested in jumping on that second boat. And the second boat's very interesting. I asked them, I said, well, are we saying that like for 8 nights we'll go up to Amsterdam, people get off, and then we'll get a new group on and they'll go down to Switzerland? And she said, no, she said they will literally boat right next to one another. And when they dock side by side and you have a little ramp that connects the two boats.
That's awesome.
So the party's there, just guys. Getting bigger. The party's just getting
the
bigger.
The party doubles, specifically speaking, it doubles in size.
So can you just give me a little bit more detail into when you say the cabin, like explain what those spots look like?
Sure. So the riverboat's very interesting, and I should also kind of say something about riverboats, which is maybe not an elephant in the room, but a stigma, if you will, of riverboating, which is that it's for a really old demographic.
Sleepy.
It is. It's sleepy. And there's chandeliers and silk sheets. It's horrible. And and the food is 5-star. You'd hate it. And you can have an all-you-can-drink bracelet on for the 8 nights. It's horrible. Anyhow, so the really interesting thing about riverboats is that that's who typically gravitates towards them. Well, not when you do a private charter on a riverboat. It completely flips like that stigma upside down on its head. Because really, a riverboat, like any boat, is as good, as sleepy, as excited, as energized, as celebratory as the people that are on it. So when you lease a riverboat, like I did in 2021, and everybody on the boat is in their 20s, 30s, 40s, and 50s, and not in their 70s and their 80s, it's a whole other thing.
And they're starting their day with endorphins.
Exactly right. And we had a silent disco one night. We had karaoke one night. We had a 70s night. I didn't think everybody was going to do it, but like 120 people brought 70s garb. And boy, did we rock it that night. And so on the 2024 boat, it's an 80s night. We got one 80s night.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. So so it's all what you make it and who you bring to it to make it what you want to make it. And so that's another really, really important piece to point out in the boat. But as you asked me about the cabins, as you can imagine, it runs the gamut. There are suites that are, you know, higher up and they've got their full balconies and extra square footage. And then you've got and you can go all the way down to way down below, where like your window is partly underwater and partly above water. And that's way, way down. And then you've got the French balconies. And, you know, if you haven't been on one of these or you haven't Googled French balcony yet, it's nice. And it's got you can open up the windows and you can have 1 foot of balcony. I guess that's how the French do it. And so you won't see like chairs and a table out there where you would sip on a cocktail at sunset, but you definitely are getting a ton of fresh air. And then you have deluxe cabins, which are actually identical square footage minus French balconies. And all the cabins, which I love about this, they can be separated into two separate beds or they can be combined. So ahead of time, I can tell them I've got, you know, 20 couples and I've got another 40 singles. Or would not be sharing a bed based on whatever relationship they have. And we have people that come solo and they will roll the dice. And I'll say, listen, you can either A, pay double, or B, you are a male solo traveler. You will be paired with a male solo traveler. Same for the women. But there's like there's father daughters, there's sisters, there's mother daughters, there's best friends. And then there's people that just literally keep on coming back and always come solo because you're never really alone, right? You walk onto this boat, you've got a lot in common with people. You like exercise, you like travel, you like overseas travel. And in this case, you love football. And so we're going to find ourselves with groups of 20, 30, 40, 50. Maybe we'll find that town square, right? With a big screen where all 140 of us are watching the same games together.
Yeah.
But you guys know how this goes. Typically the way, you know, in the first stages of the tournament, everybody's in it, right? It hasn't whittled down.
Most fun.
It's the best part.
Anything,
group stage.
Anything's possible. The best part. Anything's possible. Every single team vying for their spot in their group so that they can advance. And there's so many games happening, right?
And they're on everywhere. Like every town, every bar, every restaurant, everywhere there's a match playing. And so the energy is just always the best.
Yeah. No doubt. You know, when I went to you guys go to the World Cup in Rio?
We were there.
Yep.
2014. So great. We had a place in Ipanema with Journey to the Games. I'd taken out a whole place. We had 100 people there, give or take.
We were probably neighbors. That's where we stayed.
Oh, man. Copacabana, Ipanema. And then for some reason, I'm forgetting the name of that high-end suburb that's like a little bit further down the road. But those three, right, made up that coastal area in Rio. And, you know, for better or worse, it was a little bit unfortunate, actually, is that I was there for 8 nights. I don't go for the entire time. I wish I could. I got the kids at home and the wife and the dogs and everything. And so I was there for 8 nights. And there were 3 games in person live in Rio during that period of time. That's it. You would think if you went to the World Cup and you were in Rio for 8 nights, you could see 20 games, 3. But make no mistake, whenever a game was on, the world stopped. Every TV, at every beach bar, at every street bar, it didn't, the screens, the fan zones, all these things were just alive. So it was a little irrelevant, to be honest, that, you know, those games weren't being held live in Rio. Because it's live all around you. The feeling of the World Cup, whether a game's being played in that city that day or not, you just can't be replicated by any tournament, including the Olympics. I think the Euros will probably do something. I think the feeling will be similar, if not identical. But yeah, so that happens.
So let me ask you this, Merritt. You know, that feeling, the environment is going to be there. You know, you already have one boat set up. It's going to be a younger crowd. It won't be the sleepy riverboat people might expect. It'll be a party. What will it take, do you think, to make not only a second boat possible, but a second boat successful?
Oh, I love this. It's a great question, right? Like, do I need to fill a second boat?
Because you have some waitlist folks, it sounds like, right?
I do. You know, for certain. And they'll get their first pick of those cabins that they're requesting, you know, more than anyone. But if I combine them with, we'll call it 40 to 50 new interested people, maybe from the Footy Travelers podcast and Footy Travelers world or elsewhere.
Fellow Footy Travelers.
Calling out. Come on.
Come on. Let's do it. And their friends and their family, because I really wholeheartedly believe that good people know good people, right? So the immediate qualification for getting on one of these boats is you know someone who knows someone who knows someone who knows me. 4 degrees. Yeah. And if that's the case, we're just going to have the time of our lives. One thing I will tell you about a second boat, which is just tremendous, is that I thought maybe if I was doing a second boat, I'd have to replicate the itinerary, but reverse it. So the way that this itinerary will work for our boat that's done, signed, sealed, and delivered is we're going to start in Switzerland. You're positive they're making this, right? We're going to touch in France. They're definitely making the Euros. We're going to spend almost all of our time in Germany at various ports. And then we end in Amsterdam. I would say, without question, all 4 of those teams will be represented at the Euros. So very excited about that piece. And then the other thing I should say is like, we are going to get tickets. We will get tickets because it turns out that one of the places that we port at in Germany is, and I'm gonna butcher it. I'm not going to pronounce this right. It's Cologne. Cologne? Cologne?
I've heard Cologne, yeah.
You say Cologne. You say Cologne. Man, I can swear Cologne. Yeah. But anyhow, we'll find out soon enough. And there is a game in Cologne or Cologne that day. We have all day. Now, those tickets haven't even gone out for sale yet. And I can't even remember what it is. It's like 1A versus 2B or something. Could still be groups. But we will be in a city that is hosting a match. The other thing is, when we get out every single day and you run that race in the morning, the rest of the day is yours. It's really whatever you want to do with it. If you don't want to come back in time for dinner, and breakfast, lunch, and dinner are included all the time.
Good to know.
Then you could get a rental car and you could drive 2 hours. You could drive an hour to another city that is hosting a game live that day. You could, while you're with our riverboat crew, go see 5 live games. That's very probable.
That's awesome.
So anyhow, we'll have 2 boats and they will sail together and they will port together and we will just connect them with a ramp every single time that we park, doubling the party. So you'll have like your own little individual party if we went 2 boats and you'll have your one big party. And of course, when we all hit land,
game on.
We're all one crew. Yeah. So anyhow.
So I'm genuinely wondering now at this point, you know, with your waitlist crew that you have, with fellow Footy Travelers that we know, with fellow travelers that our friends are, and our fellow Footy Travelers have friends who are, you know, can we get this second boat going? We've already mentioned how amazing.
We're goal oriented.
We are goal oriented, not just soccer goal oriented, but travel goal oriented. You know, we've already mentioned that environment, that the front end, the group stage of the tournament is going to be, how everyone's going to be super excited, where that boat is docking, the vibes that'll be in those cities. And, you know, how even if you're not actually getting to that game in Cologne with a ticket, which we can talk a little bit about later, and how that opportunity might be or might not be incorporated into the Race to Adventure itinerary. But yeah, the vibe will be there. So let's do this. Listeners, fellow Footy Travelers, really all your friends and family who think this would be a great experience to explore Rhineland Europe during the 2024 Euro tournament. Let us know if you're interested. Merit, how can people reach out to you either directly or through a website, maybe get on the wait list just through your channels?
Sure. Thanks for setting that up. I would say 2 things. Number one, you can always go to the website. The website is race2adventure.com. Race2adventure.com. Or you can simply shoot us an email, info@race2adventure.com. And if you've got interested in a second boat, we're going to know where you heard it. There's a few channels where, you know, maybe the seed's been planted, but the way that we're talking about it here, I'd say, you know, with specifics and an agenda and an itinerary, it's here. So let us know. I'm down.
Awesome.
Good game.
Awesome. I want it.
I mean, there's so much here that I just think is so awesome. You know, Colin and I were supposed to go to the Euros 2020 and had all of our plans to do that really big. And obviously COVID happened, and then 2021 made it a little bit tricky for us to get there. So I think there's a lot of people that are also in the same camp as us, which were a lot of people, especially. I had a crew. I had like probably 12 people that were planning to do Euros in 2020. And then we all just bailed because 2021, you know, at that point, they didn't even know if that was going to happen the next year, but you had to still commit to it because the pandemic was just, it was so strong at that point. So
strong pandemic.
There's that strong. Yeah. I was trying to think of a better word than that. Really,
really, really good performance out of that pandemic this year.
grade A performance.
At least we can laugh now.
5 stars.
At least we can laugh.
Oh, if you don't laugh, it's just sad.
You know, there's pent up international spectating demand. I don't think anybody's ever said that.
Totally.
I'm going to say it. And I'll tell you, I had 120 people going to the Tokyo Summer Olympics in 2020. That didn't happen. Then they pushed it. So I told everybody, hold on, we're still going to Japan. Then they had the Olympics. But then they said, you can't come watch. And so there I was, left with 120 people and 120 beds, not able to even fly into Japan. And so that wasn't an option. I'll tell you something though, like let's go to a positive, you know, rewind place in time, which is Germany 2006. That arguably was one of the best World Cups because of its concentration. When you take a big, giant international competition and you shrink it into a country that is accessible via train, bus or car, plane, but take the plane out of it. You don't need the plane is the whole point. And you can see everything everywhere. And that country embraces the competition that they are hosting. Well, it's a recipe for success. I liken Germany World Cup 2006 to the Sydney Summer Olympic Games in 2000, where everyone says, we're in it. We're excited to host you. And you felt it. You heard about it in the media and the press. And there wasn't, you know, push back. Like, we don't want your World Cup here. Germany didn't say that. We don't want your Olympics here. Sydney, Australia didn't say that. But that can happen sometimes. And so I think the way that, you know, Germany is about to kind of come back and host another giant international sporting competition, all eyes on Germany, all eyes on this tourney.
Yeah, and it's funny, like the last time that you and I spoke face-to-face and the first time we ever spoke face-to-face was in Qatar about this. And we were talking about just like the interest in being able to do a international tournament in some capacity and also make it like a bonding experience where you're with a bunch of like-minded people and just really be able to recreate that excitement and energy that you get at the World Cup, but with even more people, and then like kind of like a more healthy experience, like going out there and running every day. And that's something like that type of adventure and that experience is something that I like always seek out. I were literally seeing behind me, I did with the Ullman Foundation that I've been with for 12 years now. I've been on the board with them and they do a trip called Key to Keys where it's a bike ride. It's an 8-day bike ride from Baltimore to Key West. And they also do a running group that's point to point where they do the same thing. You wake up, you run 5 to 12 Ks and then you end up in Key West. And it's like, that's amazing. And it's all for a good cause. There's a great, you know, story behind it. You bond with these people. But I've always been trying to find something that sort of parallels with that with soccer or with a sporting, like an international sporting event. So like this 2024 that you're doing for the Euros is amazing, but you're also doing the Olympics too, which I think we kind of touched upon it, but like this is not just purely a footy traveler type of, you know, fascination or adventure, but it parallels with other trips that you've done for major sporting events, right?
That's right. Yeah. So that's a separate entity, so to speak. It's called Journey to the Games. And again, I'm just like a spectator, right? I've never aspired to be in a World Cup, don't qualify to be in a Euro. And I definitely can't qualify for any sport, even though there's like 500 sports at the Olympics. I wouldn't qualify for one of them. But I support the people that do. And I'll tell you, like being a spectator at the Olympics is, it's apples to oranges, you know, with the World Cup or a Euros or anything like that, right? Because you're like really supporting your country, US, if it's the World Cup, right? And your passion, which is football or soccer. And that it's very kind of dialed and fine tuned. And with the Olympics, it's more like, listen, I'm going to go to women's weightlifting and I'm going to cheer for these women as they try and get this weight over their head. But make no mistake, we see a ton of football, soccer at the Olympics. And it's different, right? Because it's 23 and under, or is it under 23? You guys probably know.
It's 23 and under, I think.
But you also get to bring a few players that are not 23 and under.
Yeah.
So it's really fun and exciting and different. And I will say my first Olympics was in 2002 in Salt Lake City, and I got bit by the bug. You know, the way that you guys have gone to a World Cup. Oh, what do you have? Do you have a Salt Lake City?
I was a torchbearer for Salt Lake City.
Oh my gosh. Okay. So that was my first one. And you know, Park City, Salt Lake City, they did it right. They were really great hosts. And you're seeing the international sporting competition, but there's a vibe. Just like in Qatar, there was a vibe. And in Rio, there was a vibe. In Salt Lake, there was a vibe. It's this international feeling that, and maybe it's a pretend kind of feeling that everything's okay in the world, even for this like brief moment in time, we're all getting along. And in the midst of friendly competition, can't we all settle it that way? We know that not to be the case, but like, it's this mirage that I love and I indulge in. So that happened in Salt Lake City. And then in 2004, I went with two great buddies and my dad, and we went to Athens. I was like, we got to go to a Summer Olympics. The Winter Olympics was so good in the US. Surely the birthplace of the Olympics is going to host an amazing Olympics. Now the media will get a hold of it. They'll tell you that Greece isn't ready. They'll tell you it's all, you know, falling to pieces. And in actuality,
it's really old.
Yeah, just ruins everywhere. Apart, no buildings, yeah. No new buildings in the last 2000 years. We went and it was still great. It was still great. So my dad and I, we got gold medal tickets to women's finals. We didn't know who'd be in the women's finals, but we sure as heck had a good idea. This is 2004, right? So there they are. There are the ladies. There's the Mias and the Brandys and the Julies and the Abbeys. Abby Wambach's brand new. So spoiler alert, in the finals, the U.S. plays Brazil goes into double overtime. And right before it's going to go into penalties, Abby Wambach with the header. And there I am, jumping up and down and hugging my dad, who coached soccer for 30 years, who is no longer with us. And I'll never, ever forget it. Never, ever forget it. So at the Olympics, you can have, you know, that football experience, no question. You might have it in a different kind of way. Also in Beijing, if I'm not mistaken, I did not see him. I think Messi was in Beijing. I think Neymar might have been.
I would have to go to the Wikipedia for that. Yeah. But
there are bright and shining stars. Either they're already a star and they're under 23, but they might be under contract with their club. And the club's like, hey, I don't know about this Olympics thing. But other times they get to go. And so we're going to see plenty of soccer while we're in Paris. That's where the next Summer Olympics are. And coincidentally, it is about like 3 or 4 weeks after we'll be at the Euros. And it's really only about a week or two in between the Euro finals and the torch ceremony. Are you bearing a torch in Paris too, Mike? Is that?
No.
This is what you do?
That is not what I do. I would love to say that that is a full-time gig for me. That was a one-time special occasion that I was lucky to have. Yeah, I still got the torch upstairs. Awesome. But that's a convergence of some two major sporting events. And I mean, getting from Germany to Paris is not that difficult.
You can start walking after the finals. You could just walk. Right.
Yeah, you guys could do another, just a run from one to the other. But I have a question kind of going back to the traveling part of it, because obviously the spectacle of the Euros or the Olympics, but like what kinds of things do people do? What are the adventures that they do each time after their runs? Like you said, like the world's your oyster, but like what are some stuff? Because I've never done a cruise of any kind. So there is a proximity thing, like having to feel a little bit tethered, right? Like you can't take a flight somewhere. You got to get back on that boat at some point. So what are some of the things that you've done or that people have done?
Well, I have two answers. One is like what we've done in general. And the one is what we'll likely do with riverboats, right? And what we've done with riverboats. So what we've done, we have bungeed in New Zealand. We've gone river rafting in Costa Rica, Ecuador, and Panama. We have zip lined throughout Central and South America. And we've gotten on ferries and like seen fjords in Norway. We will belly up at a pub in Ireland and maybe not come out for 8 hours. So
as one does,
there are lots of activities that we do. There's sometimes after, you know, maybe it's a 5K race, but there's this amazing hike that is optional and people still have gas. And they say, well, all right, well, in a couple hours, I'll join you for that hike as well. So there are so many different things that we will do. In Italy, we're going to Italy this September, which is only in like 4 months or something. And at the end of this race, which is up top overlooking Lake Garda, which is like a Lake Como, but Lake Garda, you can either A, take the funicular back down because we took it on the way up to race, or B, you can hang glide. You can tandem hang glide. We've already commandeered 60 people who do the tandem hang gliding that we will attach our racers to get them down safely.
That is incredible. We'll
do crazy stuff. We did the Nevis bungee that's outside of Queenstown in New Zealand, but we're not going to do that at the Euros. Sorry. I don't know if that disappoints you or not. Yeah. Or maybe you're like, thank God. but I would just say this. After you have gone on a run, we have coach buses that follow the boats. So if we feel like a better run is to be had 30 minutes from the port, we can get on every single one of those coach buses and go to that better run, like a real good trail run that overlooks, you know, whatever. And we are doing that. We have two course designers that are scouting out the courses on that entire journey from Switzerland up to Amsterdam. Yeah. So there's that piece. Then you get back, right? Then you have your brunch. Then you shower. Then it's noon. I think this one's going to be different, guys. Like, I think that by this time, you are prepping to watch whatever games are going to be on.
You're like, I'm not going to go to the museum. I'm going to go watch the matches.
That's right. Like, don't get me wrong. Like, on a downtime in Amsterdam, you're probably going to want to check out, you know, Anne Frank and the Picasso Museum and those kind of things.
We saw women!
But you're going to be working around the Euro Cup schedule because, hey, let's also, I'm not going to lie, there's not 140 Euro Cup fans on the boat with Race to Adventure. There's probably 100 Euro Cup fans. There's 40 that are like, I'm here for Race to Adventure and I know it's going to be this big celebration. You guys know this. Wait till they see. Wait till they get the vibe and the feeling and like you could have never heard of the sport or understand the sport, you are going to be so freaking into it and so bit by the bug that we'll see you at every Euro and every World Cup going forward, because now you know.
There will be more fellow Footy Travelers by the end of this trip in the world.
Oh yeah. Oh no, yeah. Question on that.
Man. Oh yeah.
Of course.
Have to be.
And also, yeah. I was seeing that the Euros in 2028 are likely going to be hosted in UK and Ireland. I think Turkey's trying to make a bid too. That's a long shot, I'd say. I'd love to go to Turkey for the Euros, but something tells me the UK and Ireland are going to get that. And I'll see you there. There's no boat. There's definitely no boat going through there, but we'll figure something out.
Let me ask you this, Merritt. You've mentioned, you know, runs, races, courses. Clarify it for us a little bit here towards the end. Is each run like an actual race with finishers and prizes, or is it really casual and you just run?
Great question. Great point of clarification. I used to work for those big races. I worked for people that were sponsored and worked so hard and needed to win and had that winning mentality. This is not that. This is literally making sure that you don't gain weight on a vacation and that you simply plateau. You're not going to lose weight, right? No. You're going to eat yourself and drink yourself out of the day after your run, but you will. It's usually a net neutral. I would say this, of all the people that race, and like we have 180 people coming to Italy with us in September, I'd say about 10% of those are in it to win it. They're there to race.
Okay.
Quick math. Oh, wow. 18. I'll round up 20 people of the 180. There are probably about 20 people in the back of the pack that came unprepared. No matter what I said, train, you know, live your best life. You're only cheating yourself, you know, anything that's cliche about exercise. And they showed up and you could just tell that like they had the opportunity and they botched it. And I tell everyone, do not come to Race to Adventure to get fit. This is where you reap the benefits of becoming fit. And so there's 10% on each side. Then there's the other 80%. Walk it with vigor, hike it with vigor, jog it to the best of your abilities. Some people just say, I'm going to start this thing and I'm going to finish this thing. Some people are running 7 and 8s. Those are the racers up at the front, right? And me, because I race every single race. That's part of my, I work hard on this. I put it together. I've got lots of staff, course directional points. I've got medical. I've got people timing at the finish line. I'm running 10s. Okay. Maybe 11s.
Yeah.
And me and you, Mike.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you this, and this is true. Over the course of a week, you find your tribe inside the tribe, and people are walking at the back of the pack, getting to know people better than you ever could have in any other environment. Because you're taking it all in. Now, the front of the pack, they're all tight. They're all high-fiving at the finish line, and they got some time to kill because they're waiting for me. And you just start to know everybody's names and where they're from, and then you're having breakfast, lunch, and dinner with them. And I always tell everybody, sit at different tables every time. Mix it up a little bit. Some people get in their comfort zone with their little crews, you know, in the corner. But the more people you meet, the more you get out of it, in my opinion. So it's for everyone. It really is, guys. But like, you know, listen, if you like just blew your Achilles, I tell you, it's probably not the right fit. Now, if somebody blew their Achilles, but they were signed up for the race, or they were signed up for Race to Adventure and the Euros and everything else, when I tell them they couldn't come, no, gosh, no. They can hang on the boat. They can cheer on people at the start and finish line. But they shouldn't be coming with that intention that like, oh, because I'm unfit, because I'm obese, like I've chosen to eat and drink the whole time and not exercise at all. I won't permit that.
Gotcha.
It's not cool. And it's not part of the feeling. Like you it's want that amazing accomplished feeling by 10 a.m. I want to give that.
Well, and I think I saw on your website, like there are plenty of other ways and trips that you can do that encourage that and allow for you to not do those types of things. This trip is not for those that are interested in just lounging on a boat and sitting there.
Again, I'll get back to like, it's the demographic that your boat attracts and that will be who you're having your fun times with. And so I think,
well, I want a fully Footy Traveler boat. I want 120, all of our crew, and I'm going to make it competitive, and we're going to do Footy Traveler prizes for those people. Colin's a fast runner.
I can still pull 8.5s, you know,
for like a mile or two, I could do 8.5.
No, I'm not saying extended periods of time, but
top 20 right there. Easy.
Yeah, I mean, again, we've already talked about the vibe and the energy of the place and the environment. But again, this trip from a footy traveler's perspective, when we talk about the people who will be along for the ride, you know, the connections you'll be able to make, the networking you'll be able to do, and just what I would foresee as the continual connection after the trip, even keeping in touch with people and making trips of your own, maybe to other Euros, maybe to World Cups, maybe to, you know, Copa Libertadores matches down in South America, you know, whatever you fancy. This could be the start of something pretty cool for a footy traveler.
Oh, yeah.
One more maybe clarifying question, Merritt. Speaking of, you know, the really nitty gritty of footy traveling, correct us where maybe we're misspeaking, but there's no formal part of this itinerary baked into the itinerary or the fee that will provide Euro match tickets. You know, you said you could go to a match.
That's fair.
Will there be any help along the way, though? Will there be any guidance? Or is this totally like, hey, you want to come and utilize this trip as your access point to the Euros, but you're on your own for the ticket? What does that look like from your perspective?
Yeah, you know, we've done this enough on this side, whether it's the Olympics or the World Cup, where we are fantastic at coaching people. So, you know, we'll have that group of everyone that's registered. We'll have like a private Facebook group, which is, you know, Facebook's not great for lots of things, but it sure is good for private groups. And so we'll show people, tell people when the lottery is taking place, when it's first come, first serve, fastest finger, how many different rounds of ticket allocation there will be. We will like lead you to water. We can't make you drink, right?
I mean, you could lead them to a Footy Travelers Need to Know series too, because we'll be handling that as well. So, go. I mean, you know, we can.
And P.S. if you're very last minute, you want to take to the finals, I got a guy. So, but that was going to cost you.
So, see, right. But so then is there, with the other non-footy things, like the bungees and things like that, is those aren't baked into those fees either. That is like, hey, we have these varying options for all of you. And I know you said I'm using bungee as a hypothetical, but like these cool other adventures, those are also not baked into the fee itself. It's just, these are opportunities. And if you'd like to explore them, we'll get you the help, the guides, the connections to it. And then you know, pay that.
I tell you, 8 times out of 10, it's actually included.
Oh, okay.
So the rafting's included, or the paddleboarding, or the kayaking, or the, now if it's something like bungee where we just know everyone's not going to do it and it's an opt-in for various reasons that you can read or not read in the waivers that you sign, that's more of an a la carte. But a lot of the activities, most of the activities that we list on an itinerary are included. If they're not, we'll shout it out in the itinerary. But if it's in the itinerary, chances are it's included.
Okay. Nice. So yeah, it depends on the trip, it sounds like.
Mm-hmm. Depends on the trip. Exactly right.
Oh, is it 2024 yet, guys? Oh,
seriously.
I know it. It's coming.
It's interesting because that is your agenda is very similar to what we were thinking ours was going to be for 2020 in terms of countries to visit. We were going to do Amsterdam. We were going to do Germany. I think we were doing Copenhagen in Ireland. Yeah. And then I think we were thinking Switzerland too. So like you really are hitting a lot of the places that at least Colin and I were originally thinking or intending for. So,
yeah. Well, I'll tell you a couple things on that point. Number one, we do have some people on that first boat that are sticking around Europe working remotely and will hang out for the entirety of the Euros and then join us in Paris for the first week of the summer games. So, because our lodging starts the day after the opening ceremonies. We've got 7 nights in Paris, and it's like 10-minute walk from the Eiffel Tower. And then the other thing I would say is that some people will use this 8-night Euro riverboat itinerary and say, yeah, but that doesn't mean that I'm flying home the next morning from Amsterdam back to Denver, New York, wherever. They say, this is part of my trip. And then I'm doing my own thing for the second week. And I'm going to really immerse myself in some games that I've got tickets to throughout Germany. And I've got a Eurorail pass. And, you know, I'm going to go to that country that's playing that other country.
That's kind of how I did with my, when I had the only similar adventure with the biking trip to Key West, I was like, I'm 90 miles from Cuba. I'm going to Cuba. And so after that, I went and did a trip, like a week-long trip in Cuba. And like, that is the perfect combo, in my opinion, of a great trip is like, you get to do a cool experience with a lot of cool people. It's very unique. You're fit. You're feeling healthy. You're feeling good. And then you get to do your own independent travel.
Yeah.
That you can do the things that you want to do. If you wanted to just stay in Amsterdam and do all of the other stuff, you could. But yeah, I mean, in being in Europe, it's just literally the world is your oyster in terms of places you can
yeah,
go.
And I'll tell you something else. It was very interesting when you talked about that Baltimore to Key West trip, because there are people out there that are like, I'm going to do all this on my own. And there are other people out there that really like structure. And the funny thing is that the mass majority of people that say, well, I could just do that on my own. Guess what? They don't do it on their own. They don't go anywhere. They just sit on their couch and say, well, I could just do that on my own. No, you can't. You need somebody and something to push you and give you a structured itinerary and say, just show up and I got you.
Yep.
And so, like, could you just bike from Baltimore to Key West? Yeah, go for it. Put it together.
Good luck.
Call an Uber every single time. You really are. Or why don't you just come with us, because we've done the work and we want to show you a really good time. And so it's,
yeah, a proven track record too, which sounds, I mean, you've been all over the world doing this. And I think that's the biggest credential to ask for, where it's like, you've got people that are raving about it and saying every trip that you've done has been great, and you make each one of them new and different. And I think that's the biggest attraction, is like, that in my mind is what I would assume people find as the most successful as a participant, is like, it's a unique experience. It's a bonding experience with people. I feel good about what I do every day, because I'm exercising, moving my legs. Like, are there any other things that people claim as like the most meaningful part of these types of trips, like how they consider it to be a success?
The friendships
for them,
but truly the friendships. I mean, think about it, 8 nights together. Well, you know, in Italy we'll be on 4 coach buses, and we will be packing and unpacking to get from Venice to Rome in a really interesting, fun way on a riverboat, you know, breakfast, lunch and dinner on the same vessel while visiting 4 countries inside of 8 nights. There's super bonding moments here, and friendships really have been made that are lifelong. Relationships have been built, relationships have been strengthened, and we have a lot of alumni. We'll have like 50% of any trip is alumni, 50% is new. So no one's out of their element entirely. There's always somebody that kind of is just like you. But yeah, I finally found something I'm good at.
Hey.
Like I said, I couldn't find a way to
play like sport,
but this I can do.
Love that.
And you get to do all the stuff. That's the coolest part. I'm like, I want to, you're talking about, you know, course tracking and your coordinators and people that are like checking out the spots. I'm like, that sounds like a pretty sweet job. I'm like, I get to go figure out what a big group of people want to do. And then I'm going to get to do it with them. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Well, hey, everyone, listeners, fellow footy travelers, if you are attracted to an opportunity like this, full of footy, full of Euro tournament, full of potential friendships, a great buffet, it sounds like.
Really great.
Tremendous meals and beer tents and some exercise along the way. Head over to the Footy Travelers Instagram profile. Check out that pinned post. Head over to racetoadventure.com. That's race2adventure.com. Reach out to Merritt and his team. Let them know you're interested in this Euro 2024 trip and, you know, answer the question, are we Euro 2024 bound? I hope the answer is yes. It's really up to you, though. So get out there and let us know. Let's make it happen. Until we hear from you, or until you hear from us next, be loud,
be proud,
and be good to each other.
The Footy Travelers Podcast is a production of Fiper Media. To learn more about their other work, visit fipermedia.com. That's FYPERmedia.com. Our episodes are edited by me, Colin Martin. Mike Tyrone is our creative director. Cover art is by Felix Palau. Theme music comes from Shumatar, with additional music from Mr. Mastermind. Our incredible intro voice is Helen Mimaris. You can keep up with all things footy travel by following us on Instagram @footytravelers. We'll see you next time.